couple of housekeeping items. I believe you each have feedback forms in front of you, so perfect thing. So please use those if you will. We'd love to hear how we're doing and how we can improve. And if we, either myself or Jennifer, have said something that you want more information on or if you want to reach out, whatever, just make a note at the bottom of your feedback form. It's important that you sign your feedback form because if you don't know who asked for what, you can't respond. So please do that. And then also for your credits, or if you would just like a certificate to prove that you really work here, please sign this. I'm going to pass this around. Y'all just sign and your name and your company name, and we'll get started. Okay, it's all about proactive risk management, right? So much of what Jennifer covered is doing things right ahead of time so that you are not in a position where you are in so deep that you've got to try to undo what you've done. So everything we're doing here is about proactive risk management. I'll try very hard to answer the questions that were on the invitation. I certainly don't want to the old bait and switch, you know, present and say we're going to cover something and then not cover it. So I'll do my very best to cover what we can. What we will do is first we'll talk about professional behavior and what that is. It's interesting to me how professional behavior, ethical behavior, and non-discriminatory behavior all kind of interplay, and we'll talk about that. Just some interesting statistics I thought was pretty timely. This was in January of this year. As far as discrimination is concerned, the EEOC has said that the statistics report different discrimination acts, race, color, gender, etc. We went at number 4. State of Georgia is number 4. Top 10. Texas is really rampant, if you will, for discrimination and gender discrimination. Georgia, on both of those, is the 4th in the United States. We are not as bad on the disability and the age and the other things, but apparently race, color, and gender, we are right up there. So, again, these are all very related topics. A recent survey about the workplace manners, etiquette, and ethics found that respondents indicated by an 84% margin that their staff was inconsiderate and rude. So it's a growing problem, our manners in the workplace. The survey included 40 professional services firms, and among the etiquette and ethics issues most mentioned by managers were untimely and inappropriate use of cell phones. We never had that. Wearing inappropriate clothing to work. Again, that's one of these things that we should think about. Could that, in fact, lead to discrimination later because of the way someone is dressed? It could, okay. Complete lack of courtesy. I think we've all forgotten how to be nice to each other. Use of street talk and signs in professional meetings. The inability of younger staff to write a letter or an email. Imagine that. We'll talk about, I don't want to offend anyone here, but we know that there's different things that are done by generation, and so we'll talk a little bit about millennials. Lack of personal responsibility. Lack of personal responsibility. Failure to say please and thank you. You know, again, a little kindness goes a long way. Hanging up on phone calls when they feel confronted or uncomfortable. Who likes to get hung up on? Cheating on time bill compliance and stealing time by arriving late and leaving early. You hear an ethical issue in there, cheating, or lying to a caller on the phone. Cutting corners on work rather than staying after hours to correct mistakes that were made. Visiting sex and dating websites on company time. Okay. Sexting on company issued phones. Inability to act professionally with clients during a business function. general lack of manners and lack of integrity. Again, ethical. Do you see how these all kind of fold together? Professionalism, ethics, and non-discrimination. And discrimination, I should say. So, what we're going to talk about is these three together, but also how sometimes if there's a disagreement amongst coworkers, there can be a need to attend to that. We don't want to just ignore it. We don't want to just kind of, as the saying goes, brush it under the carpet. It can become an allegation of harassment, discrimination, bullying, and even workplace violence. Separating workers may not be sufficient, and it really doesn't resolve the friction, right? Because what are you doing? Are you shifting that problem somewhere else? So it has to be handled. No department wants to inherit a problem that another supervisor should have handled in another department, right? So what is professionalism? It's not about how you look, although we all know appearances and first impressions do happen. It's our nature. But it's more about how you behave. It's saying what you mean, doing what you say, and simply getting the job done. It's not about wearing a suit and looking professional. What it is not, and I bolded a few of these here because I found this to come up very often, being unresponsive. Have you ever had an experience where you just can't get an answer? Whether it's on the phone or dealing with someone, very unprofessional to not respond. Being unresponsive. Blaming. Anybody have any coworkers who just will not say, yep, it's me, I did it, I'll handle it. Not keeping promises. Playing politics. Being fake. How about this one? Putting profit ahead of customers' needs. You have an ethical ringing there. Poor communication, lying and stealing, not giving 100%, getting emotional, and that would mean, someone who just can't control their emotions, they're very thin-skinned, and they overreact with things, so all of those. What are some other ideas that you guys would consider as unprofessional? Anybody have something come to mind? Y'all got great employees
with
never an issue.
Overstretching your authority.
Overstretching your authority, absolutely. Stepping over the line is not your area. Or maybe you've got someone who is shy about asking for help, as Jennifer was talking about, they don't take it to the next level. What about personal relationships that interfere with your business decision? We're people. We tend to have favorites. We have to fight that in the workplace. Lack of hygiene, flirting, and just showing disrespect, whether it's your peer, your superior, your subordinates, or your customers. So what we are doing today is we are going to recognize the impact of that behavior, maintain professional relationships, and act properly. These are our objectives. This is how we're going to define these three things. So first, let's talk about the impact of your behavior. Your success depends on your professional image. Confidence, and commitment. That's the things you want to be known for. It affects your employees directly with their performance, the morale, your productivity. So their employees definitely are affected. What about your colleagues, your coworkers? Supervisors who get along well with colleagues and are admired by their peers have the best opportunities for advancement. So it's going to help yourself out. What about your superior and your boss? That's going to, if you help your boss look better, that's only going to help you again. And then also about customers. It's all about your customers and others outside of your organization. That behavior should be professional as well. Okay, relationships with employees. Treat them all with respect and courtesy. We're all people. We all have feelings and expectations. So, again, that respect and courtesy goes a long way. Be fair and consistent, and judge and work with your employees on a consistent basis, employee to employee. And that, you know, if you had to say EEOC, I know Jennifer talked about what does that mean, just remember in your mind, that's not fair. Anytime someone says that's not fair because they feel like they've been treated differently, that's that consistency factor. The same standards, and it's hard because we all have people that we tend to favor. We have, you know, we generally fight that. Provide clear expectations and guidance about achieving the goals. Look at their performance and not their personalities. You have to, as the EEOC says, look at not a five job performance, not about something that is subjective. What was that job description? What were the elements of that job, and how did they do? Communicate effectively, honestly, accurately, and very timely. And then finally, provide the information and training. I know we talked about that in our last session. The training has to be ongoing. There's no magic bullet. It just has to keep happening, just like you're here today. And you know, some of this may seem so very basic. Tell you, it is simple. It is straightforward. A lot of it is not that complicated. You make it complicated by the way that we tend to handle things, but it's pretty straightforward. Relationships with employees, encourage the input and then listen to them. You've got to listen to them. Whether it's your iPhone or think about what you want to say, listening is a developed skill. All need to do a better job of that. Everyone has something to contribute. Provide honest feedback. Try to make it positive, but also supportive. And then offer that support and assistance so that they can achieve their personal goals and the goals of their job. Recognize their achievements. We'll talk a little bit about that in a minute, about how millennials have a different scale and how they want that recognition to work. But it's the quality and the quantity of the work that they do. See if you can't be specific about what they've done. Value their contributions, and then respect the confidentiality and privacy. We talked about retaliation earlier. They have a right to complain if things are not right. It's unfair for you not to allow them to do that, particularly as a safety issue is a good example. And then, of course, you're a manager. You're a supervisor. Does your behavior always conform to these standards? You need to ask yourself that. Think about the times that you've developed and maintained professional relationships with employees. Is there anything that you would like to add that you've done that you think that may make a big difference with an employee as far as working with them and pulling them out? Anyone? I think in our first session we talked about just spending time with that employee, and I think Jennifer said adult conversation. When you have that one-on-one time with an employee, they're going to remember it, right? That means you have to spend the time doing it. Good managers, good leaders spend time with their employees. It's hard, especially if you have a pretty wide span of authority, right? But that one-on-one time is extremely valuable if you can do that. Now, take a mirror and look at yourself. A good example means that you yourself are going to come to work on time. You're going to be a good example of what that attitude should be. You're going to follow the rules and the regulations. We know that. That, you know, your department in particular may have their own set of rules that you need to follow. Know what those are. Make ethical choices. And then, again, a proactive approach to workplace problems and challenges. That means you need to know what's going on. And you may need to make a policy where there isn't a problem working with human resources. And then accept change. Welcome some improvements and help the employees. I know you may have a merger going on. You may have, you know, new people coming into your work group. You need to embrace that and set set that good example for bringing it all together. Minimize your own absences. Just take a sick day only if you need it. Let's, just be respectful of the time that our company has given us. Don't take long breaks or leave early. Again, the example is set by yourself. Avoid leaving work early unless you do have a legitimate excuse. Keep personal business to a minimum. Whether that's phone call, email, internet use, whatever that is. And demonstrate loyalty and respect for management and employees alike. And a lot of that means holding back on that instinct to make a comment when you really shouldn't make that comment. You just have to kind of swallow those words. Sometimes you just have to walk away. And then some unprofessional mistakes could be bullying, belittling, or making fun of employees. We certainly don't want to do that. You should never discriminate or harass. We just talked about that earlier. Or anything that could be interpreted. I think the word was perception. It's the perception of the other person. What did you do? What did you say? Well, to you it was nothing, but to the other person, it could have been pretty offensive. And then talking down, you know that would be something you certainly would not want to do. Reprimand in public. How should you reprimand? Private, absolutely. And hopefully we all have offices and work areas where we can do that. There could be something else going on that employee does not want to share with you publicly, aside from the fact that it's embarrassing to them, and they may open up far more if you have a private conversation with them. Gossip, we know that, if you're saying or repeating that, it's not good. And then talking your company down or talking someone in management down in front of your employees, you just don't want to go there. What about your coworkers? Be honest and keep your word. Don't promise more than you can deliver to your colleagues. What is that saying? Under promise and over deliver. That's what you want to set your goal for, is to not overcommit and then not be able to be there for them. Cooperate. Do your share. If you're on a team with your colleagues or a workforce, you're under a project, be sure you carry your weight and do what you're assigned to do. Be informed and share information. Everyone has something to contribute. We all have our strengths. If you're not sure what that is, then it might be a good time to sort of do some self-examination or talk to human resources so that you can contribute to your fullest. Keep colleagues up to date. Things that could affect their work, your production schedule, projects, or employees. Make sure you're sharing information. Don't hold back. You're there to help them. And take responsibility for your own actions and your employees' performance. And then I think someone else mentioned this, just avoid abusing your authority. You have a certain realm of authority, you need to be sure you respect that. What about your supervisors? Know your stuff, obviously. Be knowledgeable. That's what a true professional is to know what you're talking about. Keep your superiors informed. You want to be known as a problem solver. Heard someone say one time, you're either part of the problem or part of the what?
Solution.
Which one are you? Are you bringing up a problem and just walking away? Are you coming into a meeting with a problem and a possible solution? Okay. Be a problem solver. Admit and correct your mistakes. You really get more respect from your superiors if you own up to something. And you want your employees to own up to something. Right? In the end, that's the way to handle it. Be honest and respectful. Of your superiors' views, you may totally disagree with your boss, but we all have to respect each other. And then follow orders intelligently. If you don't understand something that you've been assigned, or maybe your employees that work for you do not, ask questions. You only learn, and I've been amazed sometimes by asking questions, what I do find out. I totally you know, may have misunderstood something. But if I ask one or two questions, or somebody else in the room asks that question, oh man, was I off? You know, so it really does help to get that good understanding by asking questions. Okay, what about someone outside of the company? Remember, and we've talked about this again, this is why these themes all come together, that to the outside world, as a manager, you are the company. They see you as the company. So be sure you represent that well. Follow policies and procedures. If you're not sure, you know, ask. Again, nothing wrong with asking. Only promise, we talked about that, what you can deliver. Be courteous and cooperative, because again, it's a reflection of the company. And then don't exceed your authority. Know who can. If you cannot answer that, know who to go to get that answer. So again, some of this may be basic, but I'm going to do a little true and false here. Since you're the boss, you don't have to follow the same rules as the employees. We're all in this together. Yelling at employees establishes credibility. Yeah, that's not going to help. This makes everyone's emotions get higher, right? You must be well informed when dealing with superiors. Yeah, otherwise we're all going to feel kind of foolish, right? So we need to know our stuff. And then when dealing with other supervisors, never give them the edge by sharing expertise. Oh, absolutely, yeah. Just helps everyone. Professionals will share expertise and not information. So how'd you do? Did you get 100? All right, good deal. All right, so this is just sort of a checkpoint. Any questions so far? Any questions? Any comments? Okay, good deal. Going to go through that one. All right, so now let's hit on ethics. And we actually have a separate portion on this, but this material actually pulled ethics into professionalism for obvious reasons. When hiring employees, it's your responsibility to choose the best candidate for the job. Again, is it objective and is it a job-related criteria? That's what you should be choosing in your hiring decisions. Compensation, reward employees fairly, right, ethically on the basis of their merit and their contribution to the department. When it comes to disciplining them, if you have, how many of you guys have a progressive discipline policy? No, not progressive discipline? Okay, it's not good or bad. I'm just surprised it's not more common. But you would want to follow whatever your policy is, whether it's progressive or not, okay? And then training and development, you're responsible for making opportunities available. You cannot offer a training program just to a select person, right? You want that to be fair and consistent. And then avoid favoritism as well, to be professional with this. Okay, personal integrity. You can never lie to your employees, and don't ask them to lie for you. I actually worked for a company years ago, and it was one of our major customers was Home Depot. Has anybody ever sold or worked with Home Depot? Mm-hmm. Oh, God bless you. I mean, they, you know, 100% on time every time. It was a very, very high standard thing. And I worked for a company that was not meeting that standard. And so once again, we're at 94% fill or, you know, whatever. And I went to my boss and said, we got a problem. Can't do it again. He goes, I don't care what you tell him, just make something up. A truck, you know, ran off the road. And I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. So it wasn't long after that I left that company. Because when you've been asked to lie to a customer, it's a very it's a terrible position to be in. Employee privacy, treat all information as confidential. If you're not sure, play it on the safe side and just
discrimination. They all tie together. How many of you guys have an actual ethics policy in your employee handbook? See one hand. Anybody else? Two hands. Do I hear three? No? Okay. And I realize it may not be you making that decision, maybe somebody else in the organization, but it's not a bad idea. It's definitely not a bad idea. I do have a sample ethics policy if anybody is interested. All right, so now, and obviously performance evaluation, let's talk a little bit about communication. Think before you speak or write. Think carefully, be as clear as you can and concise, because what's going to happen if you talk too long? Are you going to be heard? It's that turn around, you know, mom's way, people just tone you out. So it's very important to be concise. Be organized, try to organize your thoughts in a logical sequence. Be as precise as possible. You can use an example. People tend to hear and listen and understand better if you can give an example. Pay attention to the communication and listen without interrupting. It's a learned skill. It's difficult to do. Read what other people have written carefully. Has anybody ever glanced at an email, got it, and then looked at it again and it was totally different? Am I the only one who does that? I mean, we just get so many emails, right? So be careful. Just slow down and take a minute before you act. I think we've all helped. And then consider carefully before you reply. Okay, communication. Here we go. From remote worker to colleague. So I was absent from school. We learned about punctuation. Dear colleague, I'm trying to show you how extremely busy I am by not wasting precious time. I'm pressing the shift button. Or even taking a breath at the end of my sentences. That punctuation stuff is such old school time waster. Obviously, it's facetious. But have you ever gotten communication like this where you just like, what is this saying? If there's no, you know, punctuation, it just tells you, are you impressed? What's your impression? Not that good, right? Not that good. Communication is critical. Hello. Thanks for reading my email. I was wondering. Do you have any job openings right now? I clipped my resume to this email. How'd you get it? Okay, thank you. And care, Sam. Anybody ever seen anything like this? I've heard that it said that there's a rule of four when it comes to writing emails, and here's how it goes. If you are trying to be sure you're communicating correctly, draft an email, put in your draft bucket, let it sit there 4 hours, if you can. I know that we go full out, right? But if you've got 4 hours, let it sit there. And then you can come back and reread it. If you don't have 4 hours, at least give it 4 minutes. Look at something else, come back to it, and then you're like, oh my word, I forgot the word not. You know, or something that could totally change the meaning of the email. So let's talk a little bit about communication and millennials, okay? We all are in an extremely rapid-paced world, right? Things are changing. Just to give you some terminology that we all hear, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, cloud computing, experiential learning, internet of everything. The IoT world. So all of our jobs are changing all of the time. And so the question to ask is, how's it going to disrupt what I do? How's it going to disrupt my function and how I work? What will it be like in 3 to 5 years from now? It's going to be different. Look back 3 to 5 years. Okay? It's different, isn't it? Things are constantly changing. The millennial. We'll talk about some traits of the millennial and how we can address that. Millennials tend to be very aspirational, but they are wary of business motivations and often feel overlooked. One resource has said that 33% of millennials have a bachelor's degree, more than half have some kind of college education. They're 80 million strong. Now, they're now the largest generation in the U.S. workforce. Okay? The largest generation. 64% of millennials expect to leave their current job by 2020. 71% of those likely in the next 2 years are unhappy with how their leadership skills are being developed. They're aspirational and they don't feel like the American corporation is answering them. So just one quick suggestion would be, how about a mentor program? Is there someone that could work with them and bring them, so to speak, into the fold and make them feel more like they're not being overlooked, like they are an investment?
Age group,
millennials are up to the age of early 30s, right there, early 30s, mid-30s. Quick story. So I have children that are now grown, and my son moved from Tennessee to Texas, and I said, now be sure you go to the post office and do a change of address. And he looked at me kind of and he goes, Mom, you're the only one that writes me down. He pays his bills on, you know, the hard paper things are kind of going by the wayside. Okay, son, forget it. Secondly, they're very confident. They were educated in a way that taught them to vigorously defend their ideas. They appear bold and confident and are likely to challenge the status quo. So, because they're guided by their personal values, that means their personal lives can be very important. So if we can address ways to help them with that work-life balance, many things that you haven't done in the past in a different way in your workforce, that could help address their needs. They are very connected and tech savvy. Okay? This means we really need to use them and challenge them. They are the first, history's first, always connected generation. They treat multitasking handheld gadgets almost like a back body part, for better or for worse. They can develop digital marketing and less expensively and more efficiently than traditional marketing. So think about, you know, your needs in your company for marketing. So challenge them, use them. That's what they're good at. And then they're very open to change. So if there's new ideas and ways of working, then get that employed and use them and see if you can, you know, take advantage of some of that openness. Diverse thought and background, creative solutions. So engage them, which means listen to what they have to say. They're looking for employers that put employees first. So again, getting back to the whole ethical attitude of American businesses, that's what the millennial wants. They want to know the work from someone. Maybe something that you could do is implementing an engagement program with some kind of software, just an idea, if your company has the funds to do that. Prove you just don't care about profits. Prove that you hear them and that you are intrinsically concerned about them. 87% believe that the success of a business should be measured in terms of more than just financial performance. They really want to know that you're concerned about the environment and about them. Maybe fundraising or volunteering. Maybe the company that you guys don't have something that you're doing that, you know, engages them. This is a great way to, a good opportunity. Recognize them for a job well done. That's a top engagement driver. Don't do the gift card. That doesn't seem to go over as well as just saying thank you
some of them are going to want to be publicly recognized, some are going to be wanting to be privately recognized. But that one-on-one appreciation is very important to a millennial. You know, again, if they want that publicly, then absolutely. You've got a newsletter or something that you can put out. And then focus on their career development. Be sure that you are padding them, giving them a path to advance themselves. That's going to be very, very important to them. Does that make sense? Okay. Hopefully that gives us some good ideas. And I also have access to a really good survey that the Lloyd Petition did that if anybody needs that. Okay, credibility and communication. How can you communicate better as a manager? Speak from your own experience. That really does develop trust and credibility. It will give you much more power and influence with your employees if you can speak, well, this is what I found, da-da-da. Experience is huge. Back up your statements with compelling evidence. You can be much more convincing. If you've got to talk to your superior about a piece of new equipment, then do a little financial work. Okay? What would be our better safety record? What would be our higher productivity? You want to come with some facts that says that this is very compelling and makes sense. Speak with people and not at them. Include them, think of it as a sort of an interactive meeting of the minds. You certainly want to be on board with someone. Do it in private when you have to criticize them. We talked about this. That's going to make it much more effective, much better outcome. Begin with a positive statement. Someone has said it's the sandwich rule. You want to start with something positive, you want to address what the issue is, and you want to be prepared to end on a positive note. Okay? Think about that the next time you have to have that difficult discussion with an employee. We're not sugarcoating anything, but it's going to be much more better received if you start with something positive. Okay. Criticize the work and not the person. People hear the accusing tone when you use "you did not," "you should have," versus "this work was because it wasn't." Okay? Think about how you're going to phrase things before you have that discussion with your employee. Explain what needs to change and how. Again, conciseness, clarity is very important. Be clear about your expectations. Specific. What do you want them to do? I think people get very frustrated if we're not specific. What do you want me to do? They should leave that meeting with a good understanding of the steps you're asking them to take. And then, again, end on a positive note. Discipline. This is hard, right? If you have a policy in place, hopefully you do, whether it involves going to human resources or not, depending on the offense, right? Follow that policy. Immediately respond. The longer it sits, the worse it's going to get and the things you're going to forget. Okay? So if nothing else, when something happens, take a few minutes to write some notes. Even if you don't go directly to that person right away, sit down because what's going to happen?
Yeah.
You're going to forget. And that's just going to be, the next thing you know, it's not going to get handled. Okay? So at least take a few minutes to write yourself some notes. Or email, as we talked earlier. Use discipline only for genuine violations. The punishment should fit the crime, so to speak. And is it genuinely a violation? Discipline similar offenses in the same way. There's that consistency factor, right? Make the discipline appropriate. Here's some things you may want to consider as far as the discipline is concerned. How serious was it? How many times has it occurred? The seriousness, the numbers. How consistent am I being on how I handled it last time? Was there something that was a mitigating circumstance, something very different that doesn't make this relevant? And then, is there a record here? What is the record here with this employee? And their willingness to correct it. If I talked to them before and they didn't correct it last time, you know, it may make this step it up, if you will, in the seriousness. And then give them a chance to correct it if you possibly can. And we all know that, you know, very few always suspect that we have a long list of what a serious offense would be for a media determination. All right, let's talk a little bit about meetings and conducting meetings. I will say that probably a lot of us don't do this, and I think our meetings could be much more productive if we take a time to think through what we want out of this meeting, okay? Create an agenda. Ask yourself, what is the purpose of this meeting? Why are we having this meeting? What do I want the outcome to be? Okay? Create an agenda. It is just 2 to 3 points. Here's what we're meeting about, okay? Distribute it by email or memo, if you will. If you can do it a couple of days in advance, it's going to be a much more productive meeting because you've thought about it. Send that out. Here's what we're going to talk about. Come prepared. Very important. Make sure you have all the information. Come to a meeting prepared. Encourage participation from everyone that's coming. If they're coming and they're not going to participate, ask yourself, should they really be here? Is there a reason why I've asked this person to be here? Summarize your results at the close of the meeting, and then finally, what's next? Define your future actions. Who's going to do what by when? It's amazing to me when at the end of your meetings, you'll just do this. You know, who's got that ball? Who's carrying that ball? Who's got this ball? What are you going to do? How are you going to do it? So just think through a meeting, and preparation is huge. You're calling the meeting, these are the steps you follow. What about if you are just attending a meeting? Be prompt. How many of us had to wait for somebody to show up? What happens when you wait?
I've had to do that. It's very unproductive.
Thank you.
You put 30, 40 people in a room.
Were you late to this meeting, Chad?
Yes.
Tips. Lead by example. as a supervisor, ask yourself how to constructively confront as a solution. Rarely is disengagement a solution, right? Ignore it, does it go away? Generally not, okay? Consider if you have an obligation to report it. I mean, you may be in an industry or a business where you can't not do something. Double negative there. But you are required by ethics to do something, okay? Train for how to handle difficult conversations. A friend of mine is actually a trainer with a company that does crucial conversations. Anybody's heard of that? Because they're very uncomfortable, but they have to take place, right? Conflict resolution, behavior correction, and performance outcomes. Okay. And I just want to mention here that if you guys have particular needs, a lot of the university campuses will offer soft skill trainings. I know Gwinnett Tech is popular, I know Rural North of Gwinnett County, but a lot of the local schools will have courses. I know Governor Deal has sponsored a lot of classes on soft skills training. So if that's something that's of interest to you, go. If you've got employees that just are having a difficult time with that, you may want to investigate that, go to your human resources and soft skills. Those traits of being able to communicate well, you know, and learning what it means to be on time, right? And all those things that we often take for granted. Governor Deal has his workforce development town hall series, and they're at different colleges. It's a schedule that starts in August, goes all the way through November, and it's all over the state of Georgia, if anybody's interested.
What'd you call it, workforce development?
Uh-huh. Workforce development. Okay, we're going to, try to stay on time. Oh, my goodness. All right, let me see if I can get you guys online here for the link. And I hope you can hear this. Obviously, it's just a laptop speaker. But let me see if I can bring you guys up to something. Thank you.
Okay. How do you know if you have an ethical problem? The number one question you ask yourself is, how do I feel about this? Usually, if your emotions are high, guess what? It's a problem. You know, it's that little voice in the back of your head that's going, maybe I shouldn't be doing this. Right? This is not the right thing for the company to do. It's an emotional blocker that says, you know what? I don't feel comfortable about this. You're feeling some discomfort. You're unhappy. You're not sure you should do it. It's a warning sign. That's usually, again, an indication something's not right. You may feel guilt, even though maybe it's not you who are making that decision. Maybe it's someone else in your company. There could be a lot of stress, a lot of pressure. Maybe you're losing sleep over something. Typically, that means there's a bigger problem. You're angry. It could be a sign of an ethical problem. You're feeling pressure to make a decision you don't feel comfortable about, and you're mad about it. Embarrassed. You could be feeling it's an embarrassment. It's a sign of possible misconduct. And there could be fear. You're getting caught. It's a clear warning sign. If you're afraid of getting caught for what you're doing or thinking about doing, it's pretty clear you've done something you shouldn't be doing. So listen to your emotions from a decision-making standpoint. The first issue, try to examine the issue, think about it, get facts and take that emotion out of it if you're unsure as much as you possibly can. If there's someone you can go to, then go to that person. Ask yourself, who is this affecting? Is it a lot of people? Is it one person? Again, ask for assistance. And some of you may be in a company that has an EAP, Employee Assistance Program, totally confidential. Use that program. It is a free program. That's why it's there. So you know, if you're concerned that if your company or you or your boss is doing something unethical, then that may be a resource for you. Consider your options. What are your options? What about this? Take a step back and say, this isn't me. This is my friend who's dealing with this issue. What would I tell him to do? Okay. Try to take a step back and divorce yourself from me in the middle of it. What would I tell my friend to do? Again, your feelings are a good indication. Respect those feelings. And then make your decision. What do I do about it? Okay. Ask yourself the question, would I be comfortable seeing a report of what I'm thinking of doing in the newspaper for everyone to see, including my boss, my coworkers, or my family? And if any of those are no, then there's probably good reason not to do it, not to move forward. And let's face it, if our customers feel like they've been lied or cheated to, are they going to stay with us? No, absolutely not. Okay, so release your business. Follow your code of conduct. Maintain the proper relations. Feel free to report things. Don't accept gifts or gratuities. Don't request favors. Agree to things that are unusual. Is it ethical or professional asking for them to lock you? I think we talked about this. No. We talked about this with people. You have to be consistent. Key points, procedures and values build the ethical workplace. Structure and relationships work together, and ethics create value. So here's some tips to kind of wrap it up for you guys. Make sure the ethics and professionalism start at the top, right? Those are the ones we're modeling ourselves after. Implement effective training in both areas. Address the adequacy of your policy and practices. If you see something wrong with the way things are done, go to human resource people and ask for help. Avoid subjectivity with your employees and then benchmark your performance periodically. How are you doing? So again, some of you may be in industries where this is a bigger issue than in others. Doing the right thing is simply that. It's doing the right thing at the end of the day. Whether or not you have a policy, just ask yourself, can I sleep at night because I did the right thing? You know, that's what we all want to do. Okay, any questions? I know I went through that last part a little hurriedly. I'm sorry, but in the interest of your time, I want to get you guys out in your own time. Jared, anything else at this point?
I'm going to make a couple of piles of these certificates in the back of the room. So if you guys want a certificate, feel free to grab one on this back table.
Yes, with regards to the email, something I learned, I just did it with my son one day. I was emailing, and I was using caps, and I just kept writing. And he emails me back and says, Mama, why are you yelling at me? So, you know, you have to look at that, too.
Communication, yeah. But the, all caps, yeah, it does look like someone's yelling at you, right?